Good morning. My name is Dr. Colleen Shogan, and I'm a senior vice president at the White House Historical Association and the director of the David Rubenstein Center for White House History. I'm honored this morning to moderate our opening panel of the First Ladies Symposium. The consistent variable of focus for this first discussion is gender. Undoubtedly, the historical role of First Ladies has been affected by changing conceptions of gender. That historical evolution continues today. Specifically, in this panel, we will examine gender through a variety of lenses, including societal relationships, societal ideals, material culture, art, and the history of slavery. Our first presenter is Dr. Sara Georgini, who is a series editor for the papers of John Adams. She will be speaking on the style and substance of Abigail Adams. Sara will be followed by Dr. Cassandra Good, assistant professor of history at Marymount University. Dr. Good will focus on social relationships in the founding era. Our third presenter is Dr. Marie Jenkins Schwartz, professor emeritus of history at the University of Rhode Island. She will discuss the gendered and idealized role of First Lady Martha Washington. The fourth and final presenter on our panel will be Dr. Gwendolyn DuBois Shaw, the class of 1940 bicentennial term associate professor in the Department of the History of Art at Penn. Dr. Shaw will discuss the role of gender in portraiture, drawing from the exhibit featuring the First Ladies she recently curated at the Smithsonian National Portrait Gallery. After the presentations are complete, the panel will be happy to take questions from our online audience. Please enter those questions in the chat function, and we will get to as many as possible at the end of our program. Dr. Georgini, we look forward to your presentation, and I'll be back with more questions at the end of our program.
Good morning, everyone, and hello from beautiful Boston. Thank you so much to my colleagues and to our terrific organizers for gathering scholars in dialogue today to talk about some remarkable women who are still making history. So let's dive right in. How do you start a revolution and keep a republic all while guiding virtue and votes? As we're going to learn from scholars today, first ladies like Abigail Adams traveled down career paths that took a few plot twists before they ended up in the public eye. Today, I'll use fashion to explore the style and substance of Abigail Adams and her legacy. And until our doors can reopen safely to the public, I bring you greetings from our virtual Massachusetts Historical Society, which features more than 12 million collections to explore, many of which are online, including our free Adams Papers digital editions. Now, in the Adams Papers alone, we are blessed with 250,000 manuscript pages stretching over 10 generations. So yeah, the Adamses and Abigail wrote a lot, and plenty of her letters, I think, talk to the other first ladies that we're reintroducing here for you today. Next slide, please. So it seems right that we should begin our morning road trip into the past with this letter at the center of your screen. One of the real treasures at the manuscript trove at the Historical Society. This is Abigail's March 31st, 1776 letter to her husband, John. Now, as Abigail wrote, and this is about three quarters of the page down, in the new code of laws, which I suppose it will be necessary for you to make, I desire you would remember the ladies and be more generous and favorable to them than your ancestors. Do not put such unlimited power into the hands of the husbands. Remember, all men would be tyrants if they could. If particular care and attention is not paid to the ladies, we are determined to foment a rebellion and will not hold ourselves bound by any laws in which we have no voice or representation. Now, thinking back on Abigail's era, a time before women won the right to vote, when the practice of legal coverture often restrained them from holding property and running for office, you might wonder, How would women foment a rebellion, though? Now, while manuscripts can supply some of the answer, I think turning to the rich material culture of early American fashion really helps us to explore that question in full. And you see just a few samples of it here on the bottom left-hand part of your screen. You see Abigail's pocket, which she tied to her skirts and packed with letters. On the top right-hand part of your screen, you see a wonderful little sample of a dress attributed to Abigail in our collections that's chocolate brown with hot pink polka dots. And we'll talk about that in a moment. And then finally on the bottom, you see that beautiful amber silk dress that we know Abigail wore for at least one portrait. So women like Abigail Adams were at the center of early America's economic life. They shaped consumer markets. They made investments. They bought stocks and land. By developing this unique form of what we call economic citizenship, women stabilized the government's financial health and propelled American industry. Fashionable or not, their choices dictated local farming methods and steered the course of global trade. If we're interested in uncovering their role in guiding the nation, we only need to look down the streets of the past. There, women opened shops, managing free and enslaved labor. They ran plantations and operated printing presses. Looking at this terrific panel of scholars, and I'm eager to learn from all of you today, I want to remind you of a bold truth about historical evidence. Studying something like fashion can flip the narrative that we know. Looking at Abigail's fashion choices tells us something about gender roles. As scholar Richard Sennett reminds us in The Craftsman, making is thinking. Material culture reveals relationships between craft and community, maker and consumer, private and public spheres. These rich histories of craft in early America deserve our greater analysis. First ladies like Abigail Adams and her daughter-in-law, Louisa Catherine, deepen our story. Thinking like a craftsman is more than a state of mind, Sennett writes. It has a sharp social edge. Take a look at Abigail's era of style. Well-dressed elites relied on paintings. And here I'll ask for the next slide, please. Like these John Singleton Copley masterworks at the Museum of Fine Arts, Boston, just down the road here from the Historical Society. They use them as their calling cards. Abigail knew the families here quite well. The Royals, the Hancocks, the Quincys, the Izards, and the Warrens. Even if she did not always agree with their politics, Abigail appreciated their efforts to project a distinctively American intellect, culture, and class as the new nation opened to the world. First ladies' fashion lives live on in memorabilia too. Bicentennial celebrants, for example, rejuvenated interest in women's history by exploring what their ancestors wore to the revolution. And now you can make it yourself with maybe an Etsy assist. Just look at these Butterick patterns and simplicity patterns in the center of your screen. So as we delve into the era's material culture, it's natural that we find it layered with stories. Drawing on First Lady Abigail Adams as a case study, let's explore how she used three tactics to establish her economic citizenship. She was a buyer, a seller, and, believe it or not, what we recognize today as an influencer. It wasn't easy. Early American women did business in a difficult economic landscape, one that favored white male property owners and sanctioned transatlantic slavery. Through buying, selling, and borrowing, women made networks, reimagined identities, shared goods, and forged chains of credit. Fashion encompasses individual style, yes, but it's also about economic collaboration. And as we'll hear in sessions to come, it's a way to amplify women's social and political concerns. Look at a dress, a fan, or as we'll see, Abigail's note asking Thomas Jefferson to shop for her in Paris. What we notice is that women were vital in widening the early American marketplace as they tried on new looks, created jobs, and ran estates. Here's what we see when we reunite Abigail's letters and her clothes. Power was part of every transaction. Next slide, please. From a young age, Abigail Adams understood American women's value as consumers. When her husband John went abroad in 1778, she persuaded him to send back linen, calico, gauze, lace ribbon, and Barcelona handkerchiefs to Massachusetts in bulk shipments for resale. A savvy businesswoman who knew that the Revolutionary War would cause prices of European goods to skyrocket, Abigail turned an impressive profit, despite her uninsured goods often being captured by the British. When John got cold feet about what we might consider her black market operation, Abigail pressed him to continue, writing in 1779, "It is a risk to send me anything across the water, I know, yet if one in three arrives, I should be a gainer." She spent her earnings on necessities for their young family. Then Abigail purchased something on the family wish list that John had dragged his feet on buying, her own carriage. John offered suggestions on how Abigail might make use of the goods he sent and the money she spent on Vermont land acquisitions. As we can see here from this 1782 exchange, he deferred to her expertise. They also collaborated on ways that clothing wool on the grimy streets of Boston helped Abigail to advertise her husband's diplomatic prowess in securing Dutch recognition of American independence. Bold dresses invited bold talk. But green silk was hardly everyday wear. Abigail's sense of style evolved as the colonies fought to become a nation. When Abigail traveled through her duties as wife, mother, and farm manager, she followed the women's fashions of the day, a square-necked gown with two layered petticoats supported by whalebone stays underneath, a matching pair of low-buckled heels, and a frilly white lace mob cap topped off her ensemble. Color and brilliance were muted during wartime. Many women embraced plainer, homespun cloth to symbolize their support for liberty. But as we can tell from that lively sample of chocolate brown and pink polka dot silk, Abigail found a way to experiment with palette. Next slide, please. When she joined John in Europe in the 1780s, a new world of fashion opened up. A self-labeled ambassadress, Abigail soon grasped the social power of diplomatic dress. She sported trendy colors like Spanish fly, which was a bright green, and appeared at various court functions in lavender crepe, gold fringe, and gleaming pearl pins. Outfitted in yards of blonde lace and the correct number of sleeve ruffles that separated her from Queen Charlotte, Abigail surveyed her reflection and told her sister, "This is my rigging." Abigail was a sharp fashion critic at court too. She called the English, and here I quote Abigail, "more ridiculous than the French in the pursuit of style." She preferred Dutch women's wear, which included less rouge and thick quilted coats with sensible black tammy wool aprons that allowed them to move easily between urban and rural tasks. Abigail wrote long journal letters and sent home fashion magazines from the British and French courts, describing dresses and diamonds in sparkling detail. Ever a thrifty Yankee, Abigail hung on to hand-me-downs and upcycled her best-known looks. A delightful detail that we discovered just a few volumes ago, quietly and generously, Abigail re-gifted her fancy court attire to her teenage nieces in rural New Hampshire. Next slide, please. Thanks to her retail experiences during the Revolutionary War, Abigail remained a key contact for American shopping for foreign goods throughout the 1780s. In Paris, U.S. Minister Thomas Jefferson sought out Abigail's aid as they both struggled to run diplomatic households on a tight budget. To ease the burden, she and Jefferson shopped for each other. So take a closer look at this enclosure of their well-itemized accounts. He purchased and sent shoes, Madeira wine, silk stockings, fine damask cloth, and French statuary. She mailed him custom shirts, new buttons, and fine Irish linen. As Jefferson observed to Abigail, he never quite managed to surpass her business savvy in finding a fashion deal, confessing in August 1786, "You know, the balance of trade was always against me." When she returned home to the United States, Abigail's economic voice changed tone. While John continued to buy land, Abigail turned to investing in bonds and securities. A shrewd trader in private, she remained keenly aware of maintaining her public role as First Lady. Abigail was careful to help set the tone for federal fashion in her family circle. Modest, high-quality clothes that drew from European influences, but were mostly American-made, reiterating the Adams's support of the new nation's manufacturers. First Lady Abigail Adams favored a full dress, something less clingy and youthful than the trendy drapery dresses, and a muslin cap finished with a pleated border or lace. She traded dress patterns with her sisters and arranged for couture items like a $30 wedding dress to be sent to relatives. Shipping fine clothes still carried risks. When the wedding dress and some caps were lost in the mail, Abigail waited several months for news of the delivery. Next slide, please. As First Lady, Abigail tailored her style choices to bolster her husband's political prospects. An outburst of patriotism evident in addresses to the president and the wearing of black cockades followed the Alien and Sedition Acts in the summer of 1798. Abigail used fashion to promote her support. She presented a black cockade adorned with a silver eagle, just like this, to a visiting corps of New York voters. Think of the optics. Family informants in Philadelphia and Boston, meanwhile, kept Abigail current on politics and fashion. Nephew William reported to Abigail that a cadre of young Massachusetts men, known as Lady Adams Rangers, stood ready to form a military unit in her honor. It's tempting to imagine them marching, just rows of silver eagles all aglow. Next slide, please. As a buyer, seller, and public figure, Abigail learns that the Adams brand political economy was not to everyone's taste. When Mercy Otis Warren published her History of the United States in 1805, John and Abigail took offense at her depiction of his role, or lack of it, in the Revolution. This triggered an estrangement that lasted until 1812, when they engineered a happy reunion, quite literally here, pinned together by fashion. Abigail had this gold and seed pearl ring and brooch, part of the Historical Society's collections, now made to celebrate the renewal of their friendship. Abigail wrote to Mercy, "I forward to you a token of love and friendship. I hope it will not be the less valuable to you for combining with a lock of my own hair that of your ancient friends at his request. The lock of hair with which you favored me from a head which I shall ever respect, I have placed in a handkerchief pin set with pearl in the same manner with the ring. I shall hold it precious." This, I think, is a wonderful example of the perils of political friendships as revolutionaries became citizens. And I know my colleague, Dr. Cassandra Good, may have some ideas on this topic, as well as her view of this incredible jewelry. Next slide, please. Curating the material biography of a revolutionary like Abigail Adams offers us a real chance to see how women crafted power and to re-examine the lives that first ladies forged. With revolutionaries at the helm, or better, at the spinning wheel, politics and fashion often combine in surprising ways. Let me conclude with a word about the challenges we face as public historians, librarians, archivists, and curators constructing First Ladies' lives. Telling the stories of women like Abigail Adams takes time and depth. In 2018, we hosted a year-long series of exhibits and events at the Massachusetts Historical Society titled Remember Abigail. Next slide, please. After much discussion, lots of crowdsourcing, and really wonderful community partners, we settled on four aspects of Abigail's life to explore in our student and teacher workshops, Twitter takeovers, Abigail's All-Stars March Madness competition, walking tours, public programs, author talks, blog posts, and pop-up exhibits. Yes, First Ladies yield a lot of history. So you've just seen a taste of one on style and substance. We also traced her political thought and independence and ideals, We reappraised her career as a self-pronounced farmeress of the family home to understand how concepts of nature and nurture guided the young republic. And finally, for the fourth season of our Remember Abigail journey, we explored her life and legacy, as you can too in our Adams Papers digital editions and resources online, through 19th and 20th century interpretations of her impact. So lots of visitors, some new Abigail fans, lots of material culture finds that we can use to explore the manuscripts anew, and many tweets later, here's what we learned. Long after Abigail Adams' era, women kept on fomenting rebellion, often with first ladies in lead. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Dr. Georgini, for that terrific presentation. And I really liked your conclusion there at the end. Our next presenter is Dr. Cassandra Good from Marymount University. We look forward to your presentation.
Thank you. And it is great to be here with all of you in virtual world. And thanks to the White House Historical Association for focusing on this important topic. And it's always great to go after Sara, who already brought up, you know, a fair amount about Abigail Adams, and some I'm going to sort of add on to from another angle. So I'm going to take a sort of unorthodox approach to looking at women and power, particularly the first ladies today, and that is their friendships with men. Slide, please. So in the founding era, there was no clear role for the wife of the president, much less the president himself. Every action, as we've seen from Sara, every choice of dress helped establish precedent for the new nation. There was little separation between the public and private lives of political figures and their wives in this period. So the social life of the president's wife always had political significance. The first ladies of the early republic were setting up the social spaces where power brokering would happen. They were female politicians who had recognizably public political roles. These women also, in the mixed sex spaces of the nation's capital, formed friendships with men that sustained them emotionally, as well as becoming avenues for both exerting and accessing political power. And if you can just click here, this should come out. Just we're seeing men and women talking to each other, right? They're not separated at this period. And these people that are talking to each other are probably not married. These are people who are friendly or friends. Women doubled their access to power by having both a husband and male friends who could help advance their political causes. And male friends recognized and called upon women's political power. The notion that men and women could be friends was, and is still today, a contested one. Americans in the founding era were really worried about the seduction of women, and they thought that friendships between men and women could lead to this. They also worried, as many contemporary Americans do, that friendship would inevitably turn into romantic love, what we might think of as the When Harry Met Sally problem. The literature of the early republic portrayed seduction or romance as the only possible outcomes of a friendship between men and women. Slide, please. This is one of the most famous novels of the era, late 18th, early 19th century, in which the female heroine is seduced and impregnated by a man who does this by saying, let's be friends. And she tragically dies at the end. So here's the outcome of a friendship between men and women. But the reality that we find in the archives tells a different tale than novels like this do. Many elite men and women were able to have long-lasting, affectionate friendships that had a meaningful impact upon their lives. These were relationships in which both men and women were intellectual companions, and which women were equals rather than subordinates, as the law actually made them in marriages. Next slide. It's unsurprising in that context, then, that all of the nation's first ladies had male friends. Indeed, first ladies and other political wives were more likely than other women to find friends among the opposite sex. They were well-informed on political matters and could converse with men on the political scene. They held social events and paid calls on their husbands' behalves, building friendly ties with politicians out of necessity. First ladies were vital to establishing the social tone in Washington, and part of how they did this was through friendships with men. Slide, please. So Dolly Madison was well known for the network of friends, both male and female, Federalist and Democratic Republican, that she formed in Washington. She had the peculiar power, her friend Anthony Morris wrote, to make enemies into friends. In the early years of Madison's presidency, when there was a whole lot of partisan rancor that would feel familiar, this was no small feat. Her talent for creating a welcoming and collegial atmosphere at the president's house was vital to keeping politics moving. However, this picture of social life in some ways, I think, flattens relationships because it doesn't really distinguish between political allies or collegial acquaintances and affectionate reciprocal relationships. While the term friend might apply to all of these, the emotionally rich and enduring relationships that we would understand as friendships had stronger political valences. So while Dolly did reach across the aisle, most of her close male friends were from the same political persuasion. Many people at the time and in retrospect have lauded women's ability to soothe partisan divides in apolitical, supposedly, social settings. But the fact is women were political beings. Dolly may have entertained both Federalists and Republicans, but her strongest ties were to men from her party. Next slide, please. Other political spouses were no different. We heard about Abigail Adams splitting with Mercy Otis Warren. And here you see one of her close friends, Thomas Jefferson. She tried to remain friends with him, even as Jefferson was making political attacks on John Adams. In 1797, she said that although he was, quote, wrong in politics, my friendship for him has ever been unshaken. But after Jefferson became president, some of the actions he took impacted her family and her husband's legacy directly. She took these actions as personal affronts that made her lose her esteem for him, and friendship was no longer a possibility. While John Adams ultimately reconciled with Jefferson, it was years later, actually, Abigail waited longer to rekindle that friendship. As political actors, then, you can see that women would have also needed emotional support in the same way that politicians did in a world when politics were often quite ugly. Male politicians were ideal friends for this task. Next slide, please. Abigail Adams commented on this need to her friend James Lovell, a member of the Continental Congress in 1780. She talked about being sick of politics. She knew he was in the thick of political ugliness, and it is cruel for a female to wound who ought to soothe the statesman's harrowed brow. But at that moment, my indignation overpowered my tenderness. Abigail recognized the idea that women's role was supposed to be to soothe the brow of the harrowed politician because of her supposed remove from politics, but she was unable to do so. She was in too deep herself. Next slide. In fact, it was Abigail who turned to Lovell in many cases for comfort rather than the reverse. With John Adams in Europe for years and not being a great correspondent, Abigail substituted Lovell for John as her emotional confidant. As she told Lovell, "It has been a relief to my mind to drop some of my sorrows through my pen, which had your friend been present, would have been poured only into his bosom," your friend meaning John Adams. Emotion was also going to play a role in the way that friends address patronage requests to first ladies. They would invoke ties of friendship as well as the importance of family when asking for help obtaining offices for themselves or for other members of their families. For instance, when Charles Storer wrote Abigail asking for a particular position, a patronage post basically for his father, he admitted, "Were I seeking emolument for myself, I might be diffident. But when soliciting for the interest and happiness of a parent, I am emboldened and venture to presume upon your friendship and goodness on the occasion." And I want to just skip the next two slides. So if you can go, there we go. Women's involvement in politics, particularly first ladies, went far beyond patronage though. Often historians describe patronage as the primary form of influence that women exercised in political life in this period. However, women could serve as conduits of power for their male friends on a variety of issues. Male friends took advantage of first ladies' access to the ear of the president, writing them in lieu of the president when they had delicate messages to convey. These men were relying on the influence of these women as both wives and savvy political players. For instance, Joseph Hopkinson, whom you see here, used Louisa Catherine Adams as an intermediary to deliver a message to her husband, John Quincy. He wrote her a really long letter in January 1823 and basically said, let's think of this, what I'm going to tell you, as a friendly chat. And at the end of the letter, he added an important postscript. P.S. You will understand I would not dare to say or write half of the above to Mr. A., but you may do what you please with it. Of course, Hopkinson expected Louisa to show it to her husband. She did, and he wrote a reply directly to Hopkinson. Male friends might also expect to receive political news and commentary from first ladies, although such communications were usually accompanied by sort of formulaic disclaimers. Louisa actually wrote Hopkinson at one point saying that people of a nation have more judgment and more justice than we are willing to give them credit for. This is sort of contrasting her views with his own. While she demurred that he would, quote, think her romantic and that she was unused to write to gentlemen and particularly on any serious subjects, it's not really true. She also made an argument for women's superior political acumen. We women have no rule by which to form our opinions, but daily experience, she said. And if this fact admitted of close observations 9 times out of 10, our practical knowledge would be found to be correct. Next slide, please. Dolly Madison similarly combined disclaimer and political intelligence when she wrote her friend Thomas Park in 1807 with updates on the attempted Burr revolt. If I was a politician, I would collect for you a great deal of news, she began, explaining that she did have at least a scrap for him. She gave a concise report of Burr's movements near Natchez and the governor's response, explaining that Jefferson had conveyed that information to Congress that morning. Jefferson had received a letter apprising him of the situation, which he shared with James Madison. James clearly told Dolly. Dolly and her friend were thus some of the first outside of official government channels to learn this news. The friendships between men and first ladies offer a window into a particular sort of political identity and power. Indeed, women in this era took up the only tools to which they had access, persuasion and influence. Men, too, relied upon these tools in an era without institutionalized parties or much centralized power. So I don't want to suggest that these are uniquely feminine kinds of power. However, without the right to vote or serve as elected officials, women relied particularly heavily on influence. Slide, please. Abigail Adams adapted a line from Alexander Pope and told her husband that women charm by accepting, by submitting, sway. Hiding their sway or power to influence behind submission, women like Abigail skillfully created a space for exercising power. Given that the friendships I have described here mix sort of the traditional tools of political power, or mix reason and emotion to get political power in alternate ways, I think that looking at these friendships is an ideal way to understand women's power. Part of the task of differentiating the political power of women like Abigail Adams from that of male political leaders is in how we define power itself. Persuasion and influence are very different ways of exerting power than dominance or coercion. Most theorists of power, particularly political scientists, have been more interested in studying the latter. Feminist theory, in contrast, has created a different concept of power, one that understands power as, quote, energy, strength, and effective interaction. This definition of power often focuses on relationships, taking up Hannah Arendt's notion that power is not individual property, but rather, quote, corresponds to the human ability to act in concert. America's earliest first ladies had lives in which the political and social, the instrumental and the emotional were intertwined. Their friendships with men were political relationships by default. From their positions of power, these first ladies engaged in relationships that escaped the traditional bounds of gender roles inherent in family, marital, or same-sex relationships. For women in the public eye to do this set a model for greater flexibility in both gender and political orders. Slide, please. And click. So with this in mind, we should no longer picture a founding fraternity, but rather a founding cohort of both men and women. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Good, and for that great exposition of expanding our notion of power, that power is indeed the ability to persuade, as well as traditional mechanisms that we think. Our next presenter is Dr. Marie Jenkins Schwartz from the University of Rhode Island.
Good morning. I'm delighted to be here on this panel of brilliant scholars that we've heard so far, and looking forward to the rest of the day. My talk this morning is called Beginning with Martha Washington, Performing the Gendered Role of First Lady. Martha Washington knew from the start that the role of First Lady was in part performative. Everything she said and did, what she wore, how she entertained, whom she associated with, seemed to evoke a public response. She dared not act too much like royalty. The people of the United States had declared themselves free of monarchy in 1776. Still, as the wife of the first president of the new republic, she sought respect at home and abroad, and so she positioned herself as a lady of distinction, carefully considering her every move. The level of scrutiny took some getting used to. Half a year after her husband assumed the presidency, Martha said she felt more like a state prisoner than anything else. She hardly dared venture outside for fear of offending someone or being found wanting. "My hair is set and dressed every day," she wrote a kinswoman from the Capitol. She dressed fashionably as mistress of Mount Vernon, but now she fretted over her wardrobe. Slide two, please. Martha was untroubled about one aspect of her appearance. She went about with enslaved attendants, particularly her lady's maid, Ona Judge. By her mid-teens, Ona had mastered the fancy sewing and other skills necessary to maintain Martha's elaborate wardrobe and style of hair. Just as important, Ona understood the deferential behavior expected of enslaved servants, both in private and in public spaces. Whether she was drawing her mistress's bath or accompanying her on social calls, Ona had to anticipate her mistress's every demand, to stand aside when she wasn't wanted, but always within reach or hearing for the time she was. Could go back to the speaker view. Maids like Ona Judge attended to their own hair and hygiene and wardrobe in addition to their mistresses. Described as nearly white and very much freckled, Ona was under scrutiny alongside her mistress. In Martha Washington's world, personal attendants were symbols of status, not to be ignored. Ona was part of the First Lady's persona. The role of elite lady and of lady's maid were learned. Many girls grew up in homes where they saw their assigned parts performed day to day. But Martha Dandridge, whose family was merely well off, lacked such models. Only elite families had specially trained servants to help them dress and tend to other personal needs. Jack and Fanny Dandridge were landholders and slaveholders, but Virginia's grandees held thousands of acres of land, lived in large and elaborately furnished homes, and held many scores, if not hundreds, of people in bondage. The Dandridges lived in a modest two-story wood frame home on 500 acres where they held 15 or 20 people in slavery. Girls of Martha's background were expected when they came of age to marry someone of similar wealth and social status to their parents. They learned to keep house from their mothers. As part of her training, Martha would have learned to supervise the enslaved people who cooked and cleaned and did other domestic chores in the Dandridge household. They tended to be janes of all trades or children too young to work in the fields. Personal conduct was an important part of the instruction. Slaveholders and slaves alike had to walk and talk in a manner that befitted their station, reflecting the nuances of status. One did not speak to one's betters in the same way one spoke with equals. Neither did one speak to free servants in the same way as to enslaved servants. Although the Dandridges were not grandees, at age 18, Martha married into one of Virginia's richest and most prominent families. As the bride of Daniel Park Custis, she had to relearn the art of walking, talking, and dressing, this time as an elite lady. For one thing, Martha had to learn to command a much larger contingent of enslaved domestic help. In the Custis home, scores of enslaved servants worked at specialized occupations under her supervision. The elaborate routines followed in elite households, such as removing the tablecloth after each course at dinner, would have been new to Martha. Martha spent 7 years as Daniel's wife. 18 months after he died in 1757, she remarried. This time, it was the groom who married up and not the bride. George Washington owned Mount Vernon at the time, and he claimed people as property, but his wealth was modest compared to Martha's inheritance. Slide 3, please. After the marriage, Martha brought her highly trained domestic help to Mount Vernon, which over time underwent transformation from a much more modest home into the 20-room mansion visitors see today. The Washingtons entertained in grand fashion, and each family member had his or her own personal attendant. The Washingtons ordered luxury goods from Europe and tended to set them off as elites. For Martha, orders included silk hose, gloves, jewelry, and corset stays, good, easy made, and very thin. There were also luxury goods for entertaining, including wine, mustard, and sugar. Guests came in droves, as many as 400 a year in the 1760s and 1770s. Slide 4, please. When George Washington took the oath of office of the presidency in 1789, Martha once again faced the necessity of redefining herself, this time as First Lady. Despite her expressions of anxiety, this transformation was not drastic in that neither of the Washingtons scrapped their identities as mistress and master of Mount Vernon. The slaveholding plantation on the Potomac River was a source of livelihood, of course, but it also grounded the Washingtons in the class of elites who ruled Virginia and now the new nation. Ona Judge and the small number of other Mount Vernon slaves who accompanied the Washingtons to the nation's capital were chosen with care. Each had a history of delivering impeccable service, and all had proven their loyalty. Ona appears to have excelled in serving the First Lady until May 1796, when she escaped to New Hampshire. Slide 5, please. This is a copy of an ad the Washingtons placed on page 1 of the Philadelphia Gazette in an effort to secure Ona's return. But Ona managed to make her escape permanent, despite being recognized and her whereabouts reported to the Washingtons. Asked later why she had fled, Ona said she wanted to be free, maybe learn to read and write. Admitting that she had better food, clothing, and housing than most other slaves, she made clear her desire to live as a free woman, to marry and have a family. Ona's disappearance was a personal loss for Martha, but also an embarrassment, a dent in her carefully constructed persona. Ona's presence had been intended to remind people that the First Lady was an important and distinguished woman, someone worthy of her position. Ona's escape revealed all too clearly the discontent that slaveholders denied existed among the people they held in bondage. It revealed the inequity and artificiality of status built on the enslavement of others. Martha Washington's and Ona Judge's stories remind us that gendered performances varied depending on class and standing. We can come back to speaker view now. For a woman like Martha, possession of highly trained, attractive, and enslaved personal attendants signaled wealth and distinction. For a woman like Ona, a wealthy and socially prominent mistress signaled subservience and insecurity. Both women were constrained, of course, by expectations of a patriarchal society, but their experiences of it differed. One had much greater ability to maneuver in the world than did the other. They each had their own concepts of womanhood, although for a long time, one of them held the resources and power to compel the other to adhere to hers. Americans have, from the nation's founding, expected their first ladies to exemplify an idealized woman. But the ideal changes over time and from one social group to another. In Martha Washington's day, among the elite class that ruled Virginia, a great lady held servants in captivity for personal convenience and for show. Expectations of subsequent first ladies varied. For example, 30 years after the Washington presidency ended, the idea of a slaveholding first lady was not so widely admired as in Martha Washington's day, at least not among certain politicos. Slide 6, please. The presidential election of 1828, one of the most vicious campaigns in presidential history, pitted incumbent President John Quincy Adams against Andrew Jackson. Slide 7, please. One of the many disputes between the candidate's supporters was about which of their wives, Rachel Jackson or Louisa Adams, would make the better first lady. Jackson supporters tried to present Rachel Jackson as the unassuming, plain old housewife of the Tennessee farmer. She was hardly a plain old housewife. She had been born into a prosperous slaveholding family from Virginia. And at the time, she and Andrew lived near Nashville on a 1,000-acre cotton plantation where they held 100 or so people in bondage. Their land and human property, together with Andrew's previous military and political successes, placed the Jacksons squarely within the class of elites who ruled the country. But Jackson supporters preferred to emphasize his humble frontier beginning, and they apparently believed that the majority of American voters would prefer to have as first lady a plain housewife from Tennessee, rather than a fancy slaveholding mistress, or a sophisticated and experienced diplomat's wife, an incumbent first lady like Louisa Adams, for that matter. During the election, Rachel was charged with adultery and bigamy for living with Andrew before obtaining a divorce from her first husband. Slide 8, please. Newspapermen Charles Hammond, pictured here, and other Adams men hammered away on Rachel's supposed moral failings. Hammond defended such attacks as a duty. No degraded female, he said, should be placed at the head of the female society of the nation, which is how he described the position of first lady. Could come back to speaker's view, please. Mores have changed since Martha Washington and Rachel Jackson lived. So too have ideas about how women should look and act, although even today, we don't all agree on what this should be. What hasn't seemed to change is the idea of scrutinizing the words and deeds of First Ladies to see if they are performing the role of an idealized woman to our satisfaction. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Schwartz, for that terrific discussion of First Ladies' gender and the complicated history of slavery and how they relate to each other. Our fourth and final, Dr. Gwendolyn DuBois Shaw from the University of Pennsylvania, and we look forward to your presentation today as well.
Thank you so much, Colleen. It's wonderful to be here. It's a real pleasure. I wanted to start with a video of the exhibition, Every Eye is Upon Me, First Ladies of the United States, which I curated for the National Portrait Gallery and which will be on view again after being dark for a little while this coming Monday. So if you could play the video, that would be great. Thanks. You. And the next slide, please. Okay, and so we have a number of lenders to the exhibition. We're very happy that the White House lent a majority of lent works, over a dozen that were specially conserved with the aid of the White House Historical Association. And we worked very closely with the National First Ladies Library, the Library of Congress, the State Department, and numerous presidential sites and libraries. Next, please. The exhibition's title comes from a letter. We've been doing a lot of letters this morning. A letter from Julia Gardner Tyler to her mother, in which she said, "I very well know every eye is upon me, my dear mother, and I will behave accordingly." And I like to begin with Julia Gardner Tyler because she's one of these few First Ladies where we have a lot of images of her. Next slide, please. One of the earliest ones is actually kind of a coded image, which shows her as the Rose of Long Island in this print by Alfred Baker, which appeared in a New York City newspaper. There's a little cartouche on the side where her pocketbook would be, which says something to the effect of, "I shop at Bogart and McCamley's," which was a department store in New York. It says their goods are very nice and astonishingly cheap. This was a big scandal, of course, for the Gardner family. Young Julia had been a debutante when she came out. She was known as the Rose of Long Island. And at the very bottom of that picture, you can see a little rose there. And so people recognized her. Her family shipped her off to Europe until the controversy was able to die down. And her father, who was the senator from one of the two senators from New York State, David Gardner, brought her to Washington, D.C. One day they were on a ship, a new naval ship, which had just been commissioned with this enormous gun, this cannon that was being demonstrated and exploded. And you can see that in the print at right. Julia Gardner was not injured in the explosion, but her father was killed. She was not injured because she was below decks flirting with President John Tyler. He was newly widowed. The two were drawn close together by this terrible experience. They had about 30 years difference in their age. She was 24, he was about 54. But by all accounts, they had a very loving relationship. They were married in the White House, and she became one of these very young first ladies. Can I have the next slide, please? Because she came from a very wealthy and well-heeled background, there are a lot of images of her, which is very unusual for women of her era, and also very unusual for first ladies in general. And I'll talk about that in a second. Not only was this beautiful portrait by Anelli from the White House available for our exhibition, but we could have also used the other painting that you see here, which is in the collection of the Smithsonian's Museum of American History. And then there are photographs that exist of her. She was alive during the era of photography, and there were early daguerreotypes and then photographs from later in her life, as you can see at upper right. In addition, portraits of her were made into popular prints, like the one at center. And so her image really was deployed across a wide platform of media, which again was very unusual for women of her era. But because she came from this wealthy family, the Gardners of Long Island, she was born on Gardner Island, which is still today held by her family. It's one of the largest privately owned islands in the United States. And because of this, she was in a very unique position in regard to formal portraiture. Next, please. And you can see that here, these two portraits of her, the one on the right being from the collection of the American History Museum. Both of these images show her as though she were kind of a princess, you know, very literally to the manner born, with wearing beautiful silks and jewels set in very romantic settings. Next, please. And this is not the case for other first ladies. So, for example, in curating the exhibition, we were unable to locate any images, any portraits of any kind that were accurate, accurate representations made during the lives of either Martha Skelton Jefferson, the wife of Thomas Jefferson, who predeceased him by many years, or Margaret McCall Taylor, the wife of Zachary Taylor, who was alive, during the era of photography. And yet, as a very busy woman, she had 10 children. She was not photographed, or at least no photographs of her have survived to this day. And this tells us something really, very important about the role of gender in the preservation of images of our leaders and their families. Women were just not prioritized when it came to portraiture during the 19th century. So for these two very, very important women in the history of the presidency, Martha Skelton Jefferson and Margaret McCall Taylor, we simply don't know what they look like. In the exhibition, we represented Margaret Taylor with her daughter, Betty Taylor Bliss, with a picture of her. Next, please. Some first ladies, like Harriet Lane Johnston, who was the niece of James Buchanan and who served in that capacity as his hostess and first lady, really understood the power of portraiture. And here you see her in a marble portrait bust, which she herself commissioned. It's in the collection of the Smithsonian American Art Museum because she gave it to the nation, along with her very extensive art collection, and that formed the basis of the National Fine Arts Collection, which is now the American Art Museum. It's very rare to have a portrait of a woman, a named woman, done in marble during this period. And we may see lots of portraits of women that are, well, not really portraits, but lots of representations of women in marble, but more often they are allegorical portraits. They are types like Liberty or Columbia or America. But in the case of Harriet Lane Johnston, she understood the power of portraiture. And as a woman, she decided that she needed to preserve her likeness, not only in two dimensions, but in three dimensions. Next, please. At the National Portrait Gallery today, we commissioned portraits of first ladies, but this only began in 2006 with the portrait that you see on the left of Hillary Rodham Clinton. In 2008, the second commissioned portrait of a first lady, Laura Bush, was completed, and the most recent one of Michelle Obama came in 2018. And this has been an effort by the Portrait Gallery to redress that gendered absence of portraits. Our collection is by no means as complete in the area of first ladies as it is in presidents. We are the one place where you can, you know, go besides the White House to see a full set of portraits of presidents. But the exhibition, can I have the next slide, please? The exhibition, Every Eye is Upon Me, was the first real effort by the Portrait Gallery to show a comparable exhibition of first ladies' portraits. And I'm very pleased that we were able to publish an evergreen book along with this, First Ladies of the United States, which joins as a companion to America's Presidents, which was published in 2017 on the occasion of the reinstallation of the President's Galleries. And just the last slide. And I want to encourage you, if you are in Washington, the exhibition is reopening on May 10th, this coming week. It will be up for just 13 more days, which is absolutely heartbreaking for me. You don't even know. But I'm glad that people will be able to see it again. So if you're interested in it, I encourage you to go to the website, firstladies.si.edu, which will be up for a long time to come and has wonderful teaching materials and all of the labels and information and videos. And there's some great interviews that that I did with Anita McBride about the exhibition. And if you're curious about my other work, my website is below. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shaw. And it is very good news that the National Portrait Gallery is reopening, even if it's only for a few weeks, so that we can view that exhibit in person. Now I think we're going to be joined by all of the panelists so we can have a brief question and answer with everyone. One of our first question is from Maggie, and I think it's a good one given that we have talked about gender in all of these presentations. Do you view the current role of First Lady as a gendered role? And if so, how? Anybody can go, whoever would like to go first, as long as you unmute yourself.
Yeah, I mean, I can speak to that a little bit because I was recently talking about the question of Doug Emhoff as second gentleman and whether he was getting more press coverage, for instance, as because he's a man, or is it because he's the first second gentleman? And usually we think of these spousal roles with the sort of social functions. I think those are gendered female, but they don't have to be. But part of it is going to be thinking more expansively about the role of a spouse and more egalitarian visions of marriage. So eventually there will be a first gentleman, and I think he will do similar things, but it is going to bend how we think about the roles of men and women.
Anyone else who would like to speak to that? Okay, next question I think would be very helpful to our viewers. It's a question from Nancy. What are your favorite books on the topic of first ladies? They can either be biographies or books about the first ladies. I think a lot of our audience would like to have a reading list after this symposium. So if you could share some of your favorite books that you've read, that would be terrific.
So one of the blessings of working in the Adams Papers is getting to meet researchers when they're constructing these biographies. And I have to say, for Abigail, everyone falls a little bit in love with her. And I think that books I'd recommend include Edith B. Gellis's work on Abigail as a writer and a thinker and a revolutionary. I think that Rosemary Zegarry in Revolutionary Backlash also uses the Abigail Adams, Mercy Otis Warren political relationship in a very effective way. That's another great angle to understanding her. And I think Woody Holton's assessment of Abigail as this savvy bond speculator, kind of bit of an inside trader maybe for the 18th century, is a really interesting look at women's economic citizenship, something we explored a little today. I do want to just add just briefly that there's another way into understanding these women's lives, and that's their own words. So Louisa Catherine Adams takes a stab at autobiography fairly early on. She has one very anodyne version of this called Record of a Life. But then the title that tells us so much is her second try at autobiography, and that is Adventures of a Nobody. And you can read both of them in our letterpress editions here in the Diary and Autobiographical Writings of Louisa Catherine Adams. She also pops up from time to time reflected in her husband John Quincy's diary. So there's an interesting cameo. Always look to the president's papers to see how the first lady kind of goes in and out of the political sphere. I think that's so interesting. And you can read those, of course, as a digital edition on the Historical Society website. I always pay attention to Mrs. A did what today? So I think there's a reflection there of their lives.
So I'm, I'm a bit of a newcomer to First Ladies. I had to do a crash course over about 2 years. And so I relied on a lot of these books, which, bring you through 200 years of these remarkable women in 400 pages or less, right? And so I especially enjoyed Betty Boyd Caroli's First Ladies, The Ever-Changing Role. And I have to give a shout out to her because she is an alum of the University of Pennsylvania, who represents us well. I found that was a really interesting one, especially because at certain points she digresses from First Ladies to women who could have been first ladies, and talks about them a little bit, and reminds us that there were many important women in the 19th century who, and in the early 20th century, especially. These are kind of the areas that I've been most fascinated by, because I think that we're more familiar with modern first ladies than we are with the earlier ones. And so learning about how these early first ladies navigated these unusual spaces has been really fascinating. And she reminds us that there were a number of women who worked really hard to help their husbands gain that highest office and were unable to quite get there. But what would it have been like, had they ascended to that role? So I really enjoyed that book. And then also, I loved the title of Katie Anderson Brower's First Women, The Grace and Power of America's Modern First Ladies, because, this issue of terminology, I think, is really important. What do we call these women? And they have always, some of them, like Abigail Adams wanting to be called Mrs. President, for example, they've always had, their own ideas about this. And as we come into an era of, reconsidering whether the first lady is going to be the closest to the presidency that we will get as women, it's important to kind of reassess these terms: first ladies, first women, first spouse. There are all of these terms that we can use, so I thought it was kind of charming that here we're starting to explore that through the titling of books.
Thank you. I want to echo that you can look at the participant list for this White House symposium, and you will find a lot of suggestions for secondary literature. But I also love the autobiographies. I'm somewhat addicted to autobiographies written by first ladies, from Barbara Bush And it just goes on. But I also want to say the letters are very revealing. And Martha Washington's existing letters were published some time ago. I'm not even sure it's still in print, but it might be available through a library, a worthy partner. And these just make fascinating reading because you're right there with the ladies as their lives are unfolding. And I feel a little deprived working in the early period. As you move forward, you tend to get more written documentation, although that's not entirely true. You have someone like Florence Harding, who went through the Harding papers and destroyed things that she thought would be detrimental to their later image and legacy. But it's just a fascinating field. And you can learn so much about history by reading a book like that set in a particular historic setting, and then compare and contrast that with a book about another first lady in a different era. It's just fascinating.
Sometimes it's interesting to read the book by, if it's a more modern administration, the book by the first lady and the book by the president. I've done that a couple times side by side or in close succession. I usually find some of the insights from the first lady maybe in some ways more interesting and revealing than what you read from the former president. So you really get a different picture of the time at the White House if you read those two books adjacent to each other. Cassandra, okay. Do you have a favorite book?
Well, I just wanted to throw in that there is that older edition of the Martha Washington papers, but the good news is a new edition is coming out next year. I'm pretty sure that's the latest I've heard is early next year from the Washington papers in Charlottesville. And that's going to have letters that weren't in the earlier edition and some better footnotes, more thorough footnotes. So keep an eye peeled for that because that's going to be great.
We have time for one last question and I'd ask your answers to be brief so we can end on time. You know, I learned something today about that there's a lot of different reasons why we study first ladies, to understand American history, to understand White House history. But today I learned that it really expands our conceptions of power, that there's a different way to look at power through persuasion, influence, presentation. In your own words, why do you think it's important to promote and extend the study and scholarship related to first ladies?
Well, anybody? I'll go first.
Thanks, Sarah.
That they do, I mean, working in the founding era, I think they broaden our understanding and help to amplify voices that we might not think of as inherently political or as people who had political power or who were stakeholders. And first ladies just give us such a great kind of White House eye view of what's going on in the public and private sphere. They just expand the realm of knowledge we have about politics in the founding era in such a big way. And when I think about presidential history as kind of a genre, I always remember that if there's no women in the story that you're writing, you're missing half the history. So it's really important to kind of bring in those voices all the time.
And I will say that every first lady had relationships with other people, certainly the presidents, but also advisors, also friends, also servants, in some cases enslaved people. And I think it's really important when we look and study relations of power that we remember everyone who was there in the White House, everyone who was there shaping their lives and whose lives they shaped. And I think that's how we get a fuller story about who these women were and who we are as a country. And so I think that this will just be an important type of enterprise to go forward, is just to keep looking and expanding our idea of who they came in contact with and what they did and said.
I would agree with that. You know, so many of these women are far more complicated, you know, than we realize. And, you know, like Julia Tyler, for example, you know, in 1853, she writes this open letter supporting slavery. And it's the first time that a white woman has written publicly. She writes to the Duchess of Sutherland in England, and she tells, you know, British women to get the heck out of the U.S.'s business. We take care of our people. And she makes this really odious argument in favor of slavery. But she's made that argument because she has found the power of her own voice as First Lady. Mm-hmm. And so it's, you know, it's interesting to think of how amazing that is, that she feels able to speak, even though what she says today is kind of horrible. And when you dig into these lives, you discover these contradictions where you want to root for her as a woman, but as an anti-racist person, you're scandalized by it.
Yeah.
Cassandra?
Yeah, I mean, I think the other speakers here have made a lot of the points I would make. I would just say also that it helps us, I think, remember to look at power more fully today too. We wouldn't want to just look at the congressional record to know what's happening. We need those news stories on the behind the scenes stuff. And women often are in those places in the past when, you know, they couldn't be on the floor of Congress speaking, at least. They were on the floor sitting there whispering to the senators. So I think that it really helps us understand how politics works.
I want to thank all of our panelists for their presentations. We will take a brief break and we will return for our next panel at 10:45 Eastern Time. The name of that panel is First Ladies Reconsidered, which will be moderated by White House Historical Association board member and director of American University's First Lady Initiative, Anita McBride. Thank you, and we look forward to our next panel.